are basically doing P4 over UDP. P4 is basically, as I will show you later, the packet definition or packet processing domain-specific language that is currently used kind of very frequently, usually in the academia, but it's also spreading to some extent in the industry. So I would like to quickly go through the whys. So basically this is a very simple picture I stole from another presentation, which I think very well describes why flexibility and why programmability is taking off in packet processing these days. So basically why that is the main reason behind the current SDN and NFV concepts. So basically, so far we usually in the early time we optimize for performance, and when, you know, then there comes a time when we try to add more and more features. But of course, as I said, it is the driver behind, mainly behind SDN and NFV, I believe. But in that process where we basically add more flexibility and add more functionality, we should not sacrifice performance. And this is when where P4 and where ODP comes into the picture, basically. So what are the roles? So what is the basic difference between P4 and ODP? I believe that P4 is mainly, as I mentioned, a domain-specific language, which is the ultimate goal of basic packet processing network functions. So to create network functions very easily, it has a limited feature set, a limited language, basically. And the main reason for that and the main advantage of that is that in this case, basically, you can have a easier learning cycle. It's easier for developers because you only need to learn this this top language, and the rest of the system is hidden, basically. So it's harder to make mistakes, it's easier to debug, and it's easier to add more functionality in this if you are using such languages. And of course, as I mentioned it, or maybe I didn't mention, but I mentioned now, it's better for hardware vendors. So if you want to do a hardware that is fine-tuned for these packet processing tasks, you might find it very good to limit the set of language or your language to limit the functionality so that you can design your hardware to fulfill these requirements, basically. And I would say that it's a good trade-off between flexibility and high performance. So you can still be quite flexible, more flexible than with OpenFlow, which was the previous, I would say, SDN standard. But on the other hand, you won't sacrifice performance entirely. ODP, on the other hand, I think the main goal is portability. So it's an API that basically runs on each and every hardware where the hardware vendors are supporting it. But basically don't want to sacrifice the generic language, which is basically C in this case, but in the next years maybe there will be more languages supported. And I would say that is the good enough abstraction for network specific hardware based tasks and software based tasks as well. But of course the other thing is that the quality depends on the vendors who are supporting it. So basically both the functionality and the performance depends on the support from the vendors. So coming to the to our P4 project, where we basically have two different flavors, but this one is with ODP, is the multi-architecture compiler system for abstract data planes. It's a very nice long name. The short is MAXAD, and basically that's the P4 on ODP pipeline. And this picture was mostly done in the for the SIGCOM demo we made this last August. And that describes that basically you start at the first step. You start basically by selecting the use case. That is essentially selecting a P4 program, and you also select a data plane target, which in this case it's ODP, but in ODP you can select different flavors. So you can select the Linux generic, so to say, or the socket-based ODP version, and you can select the ODP DPDK backend. So basically, that's you do the selections in the first step. Then it then you basically apply a transpiler that will do a do the data pass logic, which is basically a hardware independent C code put together from the different templates that are copied together basically via a Python script. And then together, I mean, you put together the hardware independent code and the APIs that are coming from the backend that are hardware dependent, and you compile them together and link them together, and then you will arrive to your switch code, which if you are using OTP can basically run on several different platforms. So basically, they, as so far we show them to run on normal Linux virtual machine, of course, on x86, Raspberry Pi, on bare metal implementation on a server, x86 server, and it was also running on a system on a chip, an ARM-based system on a chip, which was the Cavium Thunder, but that is a very recent, so from that I don't have measurement results at the moment. So, but these are the platforms we currently support. The other, we also have another project, which is basically trying to jump the directly to DPDK backend from the P4. But basically, the compilation process is very simple. So we have the P4 program. From that, we create the intermediate representation using basically the available tools on the from the P4 community. And from this intermediate representation, the core compiler basically generate the platform independent code, as I mentioned in the previous slide as well. And of course, we have the hardware dependent part, so which is valid for a given target. In this case, DPDK. And from those, you basically compile the switch logic or the switch code, and the switch program. Okay, so now we have the switch program. So time for some measurements, several evaluations. So basically, we put together a very simple evaluation system where we use basically a traffic generator node using the probably now quite widely known DPDK package and application, which is basically a package generator that's quite flexible. It can be programmed by Lua scripts. And so we basically use the network function performance analyzer to develop those, so by a university partner to automate the testing process. And we use the P-switch node, which is basically, in most of the cases, it was a normal x86 node. There were some exceptions. I will come back to that. And we were using 10 gigabit interface, basically dual port 10 gigabit interface in the single test. Yeah, this is the one. We were pushing 10 gig traffic, which where the maximum actually is around 15 million packets per second if we are using the smallest packet size available by the generator. And we have some bidirectional traffic cases as well. So first use case was the layer 2 forwarding, where the P4 program, functionality of the P4 program is can be seen on the left. So basically, we had two tables looking for source MAC and destination MAC. Source MAC was only used for basically learning. So the unknown source MAC addresses were used to generate, so to say, a so-called digest, which is basically a control message to the controller that, hey, I don't know this kind of packet, what to do. It's, I would say, this working method is a bit similar to OpenFlow. So if I have an unknown packet where I don't have rules, I will forward it to the controller. Then the controller will populate the tables, and basically the tables will be filled and the packet flow can start. So with these two tables populated, we measure the following rates. As you can see, there are three measurements. The red one is basically created by the V4 OTP project with without using the DPDK acceleration or NetMap acceleration. The green one was using the DPDK acceleration in the ODP project, and the blue one was using the direct compilation on the DPDK target. As you can see, there is some difference, but basically on a normal packet size, so around half kilobyte, as you can see, it's which is kind of the average packet size on the internet. Both the ODP and the DPDK versions could reach the line rate on 10 gigabit, which is with only one CPU core. So I think that is a fairly good results, both from DPDK and from the ODP version. We had another use case. This was basically layer 3 routing, where we had a where we implemented a router pipeline in the P4 code. And basically that means that that in this case we have 3 lookup tables. The first table looks up the route itself. It's a longest prefix match lookup, so it's not just like you have a bunch of IP addresses, but you have basically a bunch of networks. And you have to do this, longest prefix also always takes precedence against the shorter prefix. So basically that was a kind of a tree-based lookup. The next one was basically looking up the next hop. So from the, if you have a route, you basically have a next hop assigned to it, and from the next hop you have to look up the MAC address based on ARP, and if you have the MAC address, you can look up the port. So basically, these are the three steps you have to do in a router in order to find the outgoing port for the packet. Of course, in our case, find the outgoing port was pretty easy, but nevertheless, you have to take this action as well, because in a real-life router, it is not that easy that we have only 2 ports. So basically, you can see that the results are fairly similar, although, of course, the numbers are slightly lower because of the more complex lookup algorithm. You can also see that at half kilobyte, basically, we are still at line rate. So I would say that even in this use case, which is slightly bit more complicated, the pipelines are performing quite well. We had some more measurements with some more targets or more use cases. So one of the measurements was that the P4 DPDK pipeline was also compiled to the Freescale. It's an ARM variant of a network processor, but it has an 8-core ARM processor, and it was actually compiled to that. And we could see the layer 2 performance, the layer 2 forwarding performance was around 2.5 million packets per second on 1 core. In this case, of course, it's not directly comparable to the Intel results, because this ARM core is much smaller than the Intel Xeon core. So I would say that this 2.5 million packets per second, if you compare it with the power consumption of the core, is quite good. And and by the way, for the I/O part, we also use the ODP as well on ODP DPDK version. But only for getting the packet. So it was the direct iOS, as you could see in the previous presentation. As you can see, there is a scalability measurement as well. So you can see that basically the DPDK version scales well until the interface limit. And we are just doing the same measurements with the ODP version. So from that, I can't show you currently the nice figures. We had some problems with the scheduler when we tried it, and currently we are trying to do some performance debugging before we show the results. We also run the ODP pipelines I mentioned on the Banana Pi and Raspberry Pi, but as that was not built for high performance, that was only doing a couple of 10 kilo packets per second, which was completely acceptable from that tiny machine, I would say. And as I mentioned at the beginning, we also compiled the code, the ODP version, to the ThunderX which is a high-performance network processor from Cavium. It has 48 ARM cores, and it has high-performance system buses for internal communication and also for memory management. So in theory, it should work very well. Currently, we are doing some debugging because we see some scalability issues when we increase the number of cores. But since the hardware just arrived in Brazil, in the university, they didn't have too much time to play with it. So I hope that for the next conference, we will have some real numbers. And as I mentioned, we have an ATMAP-based backend as well, where I didn't put the picture because the performance is almost completely identical to the DPDK backend. So whether we use NetMap or DPDK behind ODP, the performance is very similar. ODP slightly outperforms NetMap, but I think the difference is like 1 to 5% only. So it's they are very seems to be very close. Okay, so yeah, as a summary, I can say that that the P4 pipelines that we have seen and we have compiled for different targets. Basically, they can achieve line rate with only one CPU core in an x86 system. So I believe that this is not very bad result as a start. But of course, there are room for improvement. As I mentioned, the direct pipeline outperforms the ODP-based pipeline. But I would again try to stress that there are some very low-hanging fruits for performance optimization in the ODP version. So currently we are doing extensive performance debugging with the help of Zoltán Kis from our team, who was working for you guys and who knows a few things about how to make ODP faster in this case. So for example, we will start a zero copy based IO with the new patch. We would also go into some more fancy lookup algorithms, because so far we were using only the normal Linux generic available like hash functions, for example. So these are two areas where we are currently investigating. And I also have to mention that if we don't have DPDK or NetMap support behind ODP, that is not really useful for high performance applications, but of course it's nice for portability and proof of concepts, and for such application that you don't need this extra high performance. And some next steps, of course, we have to define and implement some new use cases. VXLAN gateway implementation is currently ongoing, and we also want to put together BNG with network address translation, and mobile gateway with GTP tunneling support. So these are the kind of new and a bit more fancy pipelines that we will put together in P4. And we would like to, of course, compile them to both the ODP and the DPDK target. As I mentioned, the scalability tests are ongoing. And of course, we will compare the results to the other pipeline. And yeah, the non-x86 hardware, I already told you about this, and we will use the Cavium most likely, and we will try to use also the Freescale for some more tests, especially scalability. And I have to mention that when we were starting to use ODP, actually the hardware acceleration possibilities in the Freescale we had in mind. But the current results doesn't show that, because in the Freescale we don't really use the hardware accelerators at the moment, which would be hard without ODP support. But now that we run it on ODP as well, I hope that we will be able to utilize some of the nice accelerators in the Freescale board. So that will be also a new topic for us. And of course, publication. So since most of the project members are from the academia, from universities, we are currently putting together a paper for the high performance switching and routing conference. This is an IEEE conference. That deadline is closing. So we try to publish our results there. Just a quick highlight of the project members. As I said, we basically have two universities involved. The P4 ODP pipeline is mostly done and maintained by Unicamp in Brazil. And the other, the DPDK direct pipeline was done mostly on the local, here a local university in Budapest, the Science University, ELTE. And we are in Ericsson Research, are also part of the project, myself and my colleague Zoltán Kis. And basically, yeah, so that's intercontinental project, I would say. And I put some references, and sorry, I forgot to put the Git repo link, but if anybody is interested, just drop me an email and I will gladly present the information. So both for the DPDK pipeline and for the ODP pipeline, we have a Git repo, and feel free to download and play with it and come back with the comments and questions, which is actually the time now. What levels? So, what release? Okay, in DPDK, this was based on the 2.2. So I know that there is a newer version available, not just one, but several. And in ODP, we are constantly following the new release. I think the measurement was done by the 11 or 12 release. But currently, I know that from ODP, there are also newer releases exist. So we are constantly trying to follow both the DPDK and ODP. We are usually one or two versions behind the latest version.
And, about the DPDK, ODP, DPDK numbers. So what you saw there were made with the Linux generic or ODP Linux implementation running on top of DPDK, which as far as I know, still does an extra packet copy. So now we are in the process to use ODP DPDK, and we started to do it on the latest version, so it will use the latest DPDK and the latest ODP API, and hopefully that will show us some better numbers.
We hope so, because we know that currently there is a packet copy involved, as I mentioned, and we hope that when we try, we will try to, of course, get rid of this, and we hope that it will increase the performance significantly. Yes, please.
You're working on a BNG sample application?
Yes, you can say so. Actually, yes, this is in the future that we try to put together a kind of a simplified or lightweight BNG in the future based on the P4 language, yes. If you are interested, I can quickly go through the pipeline that we want to put together. I think it can be negotiated. So currently, we are actually want to put together a European IET, I don't know what kind of project, is smaller, not the big framework program, but the smaller one, and ICT, I think, or something like that. And we want, of course, for that, partners would be very much welcome. Yes, please. Yes, please. Yes, thank you for the question. So what we are doing in this case to avoid locks, because we want to avoid locks basically at all costs, we are using RSS in the ingress, so to come to different CPUs basically based on hash. And the and in the CP was a, if we have to use counters, which we sometimes we have, then basically we have a counter pool based on the CPU ID. And then if there is a request for the counter, then of course the controller kind of thread will collect these. But there is no look needed for the for updating the counter or looking up the structure. Yes, most we try to use mostly CPU based or core based structures because of that. But it's actually hidden in the backend, so that's the nice thing in P4 that you don't need to take care of this. It is actually hidden in the backend. In update case, so if you want to update the table itself, there is an active standby copy mechanism, and you only change the pointer basically. This was Intel Xeon for most of them. The same platform. Actually, it was a slightly different machine, but it's 2630 or 2620. So like I think there is a probably 100 megahertz difference between those. But number of cores and memory, that was quite equal. Some more questions, or we can go to the next presenter, probably. Then thank you very much.